Bulletin. Our last visioning session is happening on Thursday, May 9th. This is going to be in person, and we have several sessions on this day. The sign-up sheets are available in the Narthex, and you can sign up to any convenient session that is convenient to you. If you cannot attend the in-person session, we also have a Zoom session on Monday, May 13th, from 7:30 p.m. to 9 p.m. And to sign up, call the church office or email Amaka, Arka, and Stephanie. The youth will be having a laser tag event at Laser Max Tag Whitby on Friday, April 26th at 7:30 p.m. Today is the last day to register, and the deadline is 5 p.m. And you can email or contact Pastor Esther to register. It is open for all youths aged 12 to 18. So invite your friends and have a wonderful time. A huge thank you to Jean Mott and her team for making and selling the delicious Easter egg treats. The love put into sharing this talent was certainly enjoyed by all who tasted them. Thank you. There is a Zoom coffee chat session organized by Women at St. Paul's on Women's Heart Health on Thursday, April 25th at 10 a.m. If you are not on our email list, email women@stpaulsonthehill.com to receive a link to the Zoom session. Please stand for our opening song. I sing the mighty power of God. And during the song, children and youth will leave for Sunday school and youth group. Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
May his grace and peace be with you.
May he fill our hearts with joy.
As we remain standing, let us say together the Collect for Purity. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. And let us say together the collect of the day. O God, your Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread. Open the eyes of our faith that we may see him in his redeeming work, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the first reading.
First reading, Psalm 4. You are my God and protector. Please answer my prayer. I was in terrible distress, but you set me free. Now have pity and listen as I pray. How long will you people refuse to respect me? You love foolish things and you run after what is worthless. The Lord has chosen everyone who is faithful to be his very own, and he answers my prayers. But each of you had better tremble and turn from your sins. Silently search your heart as you lie in bed. Offer the proper sacrifices and trust the Lord. There are some who ask, who will be good to us? Let your kindness, Lord, shine brightly on us. You brought me more happiness than a rich harvest of grain and grapes. I can lie down and sleep soundly because you, Lord, will keep me safe. This is the word of the Lord.
Sets down her purse and comes to the front, I'd invite you to take out the scripture reading that you would have received from one of the ushers. We're doing something a little bit different today. We're going to be doing a live Bible study of sorts. And if you got here early and had a chance to read through, I'm inviting you to underline or circle as Janet reads any scripture, any word or phrase that jumps out to you, anything that really speaks to you with an exclamation mark, anything that raises questions for you with a question mark. And as you listen to the text being read and follow along, you can ask yourself if there's any word of challenge, any word of comfort, any word of correction that you hear the Spirit speaking to you through this passage today. So Janet, I welcome you to come forward and lead us in the reading of scripture. Yeah.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke, verses 36 to 48.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
And pray for God to open the eyes. And pray for God to open the eyes of his word. And take a moment before the service starts to read through the passage. I'll just start here. Okay. While they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet and see that it is I myself. Touch me and see me, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. Yet, for all their joy, they were still disbelieving and wondering, And he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" And they gave him a piece of broiled fish. And he took it and ate in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled. And then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Let's bow our heads and let's pray. Loving and gracious God, we thank you for your holy word, for your scriptures, by which you encourage us, instruct us, comfort us, challenge and correct us. Speak to each one of us this morning through your Holy Spirit. Enliven our hearts and minds to hear and receive your word. And thank you for your living word, Jesus Christ. So guide us now, we pray, in his name. Amen. As I mentioned, we're doing something a little different this morning. I'm not doing a traditional sermon. Instead, I'm going to demonstrate to you the process by which I prepare a sermon, which is essentially doing a Bible study. I like to do this kind of exercise at least once a year in a sermon, because I think when we build our skills for studying scripture, we are encouraged to spend more time in God's word. So I'm using a gospel this morning because most of the gospel is narrative. There are some parts, like there are sermons like the Sermon on the Mount, but this is a passage that's easy for me to use as an illustration. So when there's a story, there's usually an action and dialogue, and together, these two things will give us the theme of the passage. So in our passage today, I would say the theme is this: as the scriptures foretold, Jesus is risen, and that is good news for the world. So that's a very simple reading that you can get just from a simple once through reading. You can understand the general gist of a passage. But when you're studying the Bible in the way that I do to prepare for a sermon, or like you would in a Bible study, you're going much more deep, and you're engaging on a more personal level with God's word, and that's where the transformation can happen. So instead of just a surface reading of this text, Jesus the Savior is alive, and that's good news for everyone. Hopefully, through a deep study of Scripture, you emerge saying, "Jesus, my Savior, is alive, and that's good news for me today in my life." So we're going to work through this passage together, and you're going to see the work that I did on the screen, but keep your own handout handy, just as a reference point. When I'm studying a scripture passage, I do exactly the kind of work that I asked you to do, which is you underline or circle the things that jump out at you, words or phrases that repeat. I'll put a question mark beside things that raise questions for me, exclamation points if it touches my heart in some way, a word of challenge, a word of correction, a word of encouragement or comfort. So what you're going to see on the screen are the things that jumped out for me, and that may very well be different than the things that jumped out for you, and that's okay, because this is a personal engagement with God's word. So because my message this morning is an illustration of my process of sermon writing and a process of doing a Bible study, it's going to feel a little bit messy. It's not going to be a nice, tidy, thematic sermon like I usually deliver. I'll do that next week. You'll get that back next week. So let's get started. So first, when I'm about to read a passage of Scripture, I begin with a prayer. I ask God, through His Holy Spirit, to open my mind to understand His Word. And then I look at the context. I read what comes before the passage I'm reading so that I understand what's going on, because often what comes before helps us to interpret the passage that we're reading. So in today's passage, just before this passage, Jesus was on the road with two unnamed disciples to Emmaus, and they were shocked and surprised by this encounter with the risen Christ. Jesus had just died, and the disciples still thought he was dead. In today's reading, Jesus appears to 11 disciples and an unnumbered number of friends, but including those two followers of Jesus from Emmaus. So I'm pretty sure they were probably talking about what had gone on Emmaus and what on earth all of this meant, and could it possibly be Jesus, and how, right? So that's the context. And as they were all in this conversation, everyone anxious and unsure, Luke tells us that Jesus came and stood in the midst of them. And as you can see from my underlined text, what Jesus said next is what caught my attention. He offers a blessing. Peace be with you. Raise your hand if, I know many of you didn't have a chance, but raise your hand if that was one of the things that jumped out for you in this passage. Okay, yeah. Reflecting on this greeting, I Googled peace in Luke's gospel. You can do that. This is called a word search. And for those of you who prefer the old school way of doing it with paper, this is called a reference Bible. And at the back of the Bible, they have, you can do word searches. So you could look up peace in the Bible, and it'll give you all the references to peace. I like Google because it's much faster. So I realized that peace is actually a theme in Luke's gospel, starting with the hymns of Zechariah, the angels, and Simeon. And of course, Jesus elsewhere talks a lot about peace. He said to his disciples, "Peace I leave with you, my perfect peace I give you." As I remembered from our study on Ephesians, Paul says that Christ is actually the world's peace bringer. Paul wrote, "For Christ himself is our peace. He came and preached peace to you who are far away and peace to you who are near." So on the basis of that word search, I knew that this phrase, "peace be with you," is really important idea in the New Testament and in the post-Easter reality. I put an exclamation mark because for me personally, in our anxious world, doesn't peace, this gift of peace, sound like such a precious thing? Couldn't we all use more peace? And I put a question, how do we receive the peace of Christ? Because there's a lot of anxiety even in our church, and I have moments of real worry. So that really struck me. How do we receive the peace of Christ? Well, we look for, when we have spiritual questions, we look to Scripture for the answer. And I decided to stick with today's passage. Jesus begins by saying, "Peace be with you." It's clearly a gift he wants to give. How does the peace potentially is given? Just in this encounter with these disciples. So I went back to the text and I reread the story again. This is what a deep reading looks like. And there were two things that I noticed about this encounter with the disciples. One, the obvious one, Jesus' presence, right? His presence scared them, but eventually it was through his presence with them that they began to believe and to find peace. So Jesus was present with them, and through his presence, fear began to dispel. And the second thing that happened in this passage that was notable was Jesus taking time to explain what God was up to. Why was he back? Why was he resurrected? And he did so going through the Holy Scriptures. So Jesus' presence and Jesus explaining what on earth God is up to through the Scriptures. And so I asked myself, all right, is this a way that Christ gives his peace to us today? So do you see how that investigation raised two avenues to explore? Now, if you were in a Bible study group with other Christians, you might ask each other, well, has anybody found peace in studying Scripture and understanding God's purposes for our world? And that would be a little conversation. But this is a sermon, and I know you want to get home in time for lunch, so I'm just going to tell you what I thought about on my own. So while I was thinking about this idea of peace coming through understanding what God is doing in Jesus, connected to Scripture, I just happened to think about my friend Bill. You know how these things sometimes come to mind? Well, Bill came to mind because he had shared with me some time back how he discovered peace at a point in his life when he began to really understand what it means to say that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. So this was at a time he had lived for decades without a lot of peace in his life. He's a professional, and he was at that time really focused on his career, making money, and he works in a very demanding, high-stress field. He did not have a lot of peace. He was stressed a lot of the time. By his own description, he was a casual believer. He believed in Jesus, it hadn't made a deep connection. He believed in Jesus, and that was sort of it. He went to church occasionally. And then his mom died. And this blew apart his world. It was shocking and unexpected, and he loved his mother. And in his grief, between the shock and the grief, he found himself really questioning his life priorities. He said he realized, life is short, eternity is long, and you can't take your money with you. And suddenly he found that he was less interested in being materially successful and a lot more interested in figuring out what this life is about, what this life is for. So Bill started reading his Bible every day, and he slowly began to live his life differently, in a way that he felt was eternally significant. Slowly, as he read Scripture, God changed his heart. He said that he began to find new peace and new contentment because he realized that living well doesn't mean that you have to win, 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 always win, right? Always be winning. He still faces disappointments and losses, but he said, even though it hurts, having this gospel perspective has helped him move through these sorrows, not without pain, but with hope and with peace, because he understands that his challenges are time limited. He really enjoys the good blessings when they come because he knows they're time limited too. And he holds all of these in the face of the good news that God has something better for him in this world. So understanding God's purposes for our lives and for this world and leaning on God's promises has brought Bill peace. And maybe when you're reflecting on this passage, you might yourself say, oh, I remember a time where Scripture brought me peace. We're going to jump down a little bit further, not quite verse by verse, but while I was reading this passage the first time round, that's what I underlined from verses 44 to 45. That Jesus was talking, everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, the Psalms must be fulfilled. And then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. So I think this passage really makes the connection. It's not just about intellectually understanding what God is up to in this world. It's about engaging with God's word. There's something really special about the Bible and about allowing the peace of Christ to touch our hearts and minds in understanding what God is up to. Scripture helps us to ground our hearts in God's promises. Scripture is where we find the truth of God's assurances. Rooting our minds in truth, holding on to God's assurances as revealed to us in Scripture, is a way to know the peace of Christ. Next slide. So as I was thinking about the second question, so how do we experience the peace of Christ if it's somehow connected to the presence of Christ? Obviously, Jesus is not physically present to us like he was to those early disciples. So I jotted down some notes, and if you've been in church for some time, you probably would have come up with these too. So I thought we experience the presence of Christ in worship, corporate worship like this, and in prayer. Scripture tells us that where two or three believers are gathered together, there will he be. So Jesus is here. The Spirit of Christ is present and moving in our midst. When you meet in a Bible study, Jesus is there. When you meet with a Christian friend and talk about spiritual things and pray together, Jesus is there. And then I thought about the gift of being prayed for by other Christians is a way we receive the peace of Christ. And that came to mind because I happened to have had a conversation with one of our parishioners who told me how important the anointing ministry was for her, and that through the prayers of fellow believers praying for her and her needs, she experiences God's guidance, God's peace, God's assurance, God's hope. So that anointing ministry and prayer ministry where two or three gather together is a place where she has encountered peace. So that's me with short hair. That's me thinking about the points that I'm now sharing with you while I was preparing this week. So the other thing that I thought about was meditation at night. And I think I got to thinking about prayer and being anxious at night. You don't have to put your hand up, but if I'm anxious, the first thing that's going to be affected is my sleep. Can anybody relate to that? Yes. Okay, a few hands. And I thought about anxiety because the other reading and sleep, because our reading in Psalm 4, it talks about a guy who can't sleep at night. He can't sleep because everything is so stressful. And the psalmist connects prayer and the presence of God with peace and relief from anxiety. I thought, that's interesting. The psalmist reminds us that when we pray before bed, what we're doing is we're releasing our troubles from the day, and we're attesting before we sleep our trust that God is mighty, God is powerful, and we're just creatures, and he's got this. The psalmist writes, "I will both lie down and sleep in peace, for you alone, O God, make me lie down in safety." Isn't that a beautiful scripture? And that scripture is an affirmation of the truth of God. And I thought, well, for me personally, this is my personal engagement with Scripture. I don't find that praying about whatever I'm worrying about helps me before bed. God, help me, guide me in this situation, give me strength. But what settles my mind and opens me to the peace of Christ is listening to Scripture, to the assurance of God's word, and praying with others. It's meditation. And I should get shares in this Lectio 365 app because I keep talking about it, but I use this every night before I go to sleep. It is absolutely beautiful. I feel like I'm praying with other believers because there's usually two voices, male and female, and they just guide you through readings from scripture. They guide you through releasing the worries of the day, settling into God's presence, affirming God's goodness in your life, his presence with you. And it brings me peace so much that I usually don't stay awake for the end of it. I usually am falling asleep. And I think falling asleep in the presence of Christ is just a beautiful thing. Falling asleep in our Abba's arms. So you can see how, like, all over the map my thinking was as I was reading through the Bible. And that's what happens. That's a very normal process when we're studying scripture. On Sunday morning, I tidy it all up for you. I'll give you a bunch of illustrations. I'll choose one theme, and it's nice and tidy. But this is what sermon preparation looks like and what my study of scripture looks like. It's all over the place. I tend to connect my reflections on the text with things that I know elsewhere in scripture. As I'm reading a passage, it brings to mind conversations I've had, sermons I've heard, things in my own life. And this, I think, is the Holy Spirit at work, guiding my reflections, opening my heart and my mind to whatever it is he wants to teach me, to encourage me, to comfort me, because I'm engaging with my life and scripture. I hope that's obvious in the stories I've been telling. All right. So now to the next section, verses 38 to 43. Those are the things I underlined when I was going through the text. That's what jumped out to me. My hands and feet touch me and see flesh and bones. He showed them his hands and his feet. He took and ate the fish in their presence. So what really struck me in this passage, Luke is clearly emphasizing the materiality of Jesus's body. Jesus was not resurrected as a ghost. He ate a meal. His body had flesh and bones. It was a new body. But God raised Jesus physically from the dead. Clearly, Luke wants to emphasize that point here. And so, as I reflect on that, okay, so this is really important for Luke. Why does it matter for me as a believer today? Why should I care about Jesus' bodily resurrection when I don't see Jesus walking around bodily resurrected today? We already know he rose from the dead in a body. Why does it still matter to me? Well, as I was reflecting on this, it's a word of encouragement to me today, still today, because a lot of people don't believe in Jesus, right? The bodily resurrection of the dead reminds me, okay, so Jesus wasn't just a human. And in fact, Christ's resurrection is God's endorsement that, yes, this is my son. He is the fulfillment of scripture. He is my plan to save this world. And you can trust what he says and place your hope in him. Without Christ's physical resurrection from the dead, none of the promises Jesus made would be known to be trustworthy, including this gift, this incredible gift of forgiveness of sins, and the hope of eternal life, and the presence of Christ with us today. Christ's bodily resurrection also reminds us that God is redeeming all creation, not just human souls. Like, we usually just talk about souls going to heaven, and the body is just an empty casing and no good anymore. But that's not actually the totality of what Scripture says is God's plan for our world through Jesus Christ. Jesus, God has a plan for the redemption of all creation, the material word, to one day renew all creation. God so loves this world. This is my Father's world. This means for me as a believer in 2024, that how I treat this creation, this material world that God so loves, matters. How I interact with animals or care for resources, my own physical body, the physical needs of people around me, those who hunger, All of that should be in line with this Easter message that God loves this material world so much so that we believe in the resurrection of the dead, that we are going to one day have new bodies like Jesus. Lastly, the resurrection of the body, I think, offers a word of comfort when our bodies age or grow sick. I thought about this. I've just come off sick leave. This was an important passage for me. It's frustrating when our bodies fail and stop working like they do. I have talked to many of you who said, "Ugh, my darn arthritis," right? It's frustrating when your body doesn't do, when you get sick or when it doesn't work. St. Paul says this is a very human frustration. And he identified this when he wrote, "For while we are in this tent, we groan," this physical body, "and we're burdened because we do not wish to be unclothed." We don't want to just, it's hard to leave your human body, like to imagine death and leaving this human body. We want to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling so that what is mortal may be swallowed up with life. I had not thought of this before, but I think our groaning in our bodies really does suggest that God has hardwired us for this desire for newly heavenly redeemed resurrected bodies like Jesus, for a new heaven and a new earth, because we love this world. So when our bodies fail, like, be kind to yourself. It is hard. It is frustrating. We are deeply connected to our bodies, and God understands that. And we know that one day we will be clothed in resurrected bodies, so we can hold that perspective where there will be no more death or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. Now, you may be sitting there this morning and saying, "Oh my goodness, I would not have got all of that from a reading of scripture by myself at home." And that is okay. That is what Google is for. That's what Bible studies guides are for. That's what Sunday morning sermons and small group Bible studies are for. We can learn and study scripture together as the body of Christ. But when you're studying scripture on your own, a deep study, it's enough to find just one word that you feel God speaking to you through his Holy Spirit, a word of comfort that speaks to you in your reality in this moment, a word of comfort, a word of challenge, a word of assurance, a word of truth. And if you have questions, then you can bring them to church, and you can, it's an opportunity to learn more. All right, our final section, verses 46 to 48. I highlighted here, you know, Jesus explained to them what God was doing, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins, what God had done in him, is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem, and you are witnesses. I underline proclaim because it stopped me short. Probably this was a corrective for me, because the question I asked myself was, okay, so if this is the post-Easter mandate for Christians, how often am I proclaiming to people outside the church this good news? How often are we as a church sharing with our neighbors what God has done in Jesus and the hope that we have found and the peace? And so my second question was also the answer I'll leave you. My answer to that question was not much, and I asked a second question. So how can we as a church encourage one another to do more? And how can I be responsive in my own life when opportunities arise? And so I think my own prayer is, Lord, help me to be attentive and to find courage when those opportunities arise. All right, so that's it. That was my pre-Sunday morning sermon prep. It's also what I do when I do a Bible study. I hope you try digging deeper into Scripture. Try out these tools at home. Take home that sheet, put it in your Bible. because the questions at the top you can really use for any passage of Scripture. Pray before you read Scripture. Ask God's Spirit to open your mind to understand God's Word. And you should do this with a sense of expectation. Jesus is alive. He is present. You can expect the Spirit of Christ to be with you as you read Scripture and to open your mind, just as Jesus opened the minds of the disciples to his holy word. You can expect the Spirit to encourage you, to direct you, to comfort and challenge you as you deeply study his word. Because, as St. Luke reminded us this morning, God raised Jesus from the dead in fulfillment of the Scriptures. And through Jesus, God wants to bring peace to our minds, peace to our hearts, and peace to this world. Jesus, our Savior, is alive, and he is the best news for us today. Amen.
Please stand for the praise song. May the mind of Christ my Savior. Confess our faith as we say together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please sit or kneel for the prayers of the people.
Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, thank you for gathering us in your presence, both those of us in the building and with those who join us online. We are so thankful for our church family, and we ask that you would bind us together with each other and with you, our holy and loving God. We thank you for the generous way you have provided for our needs at St. Paul's, and pray for our clergy, Canon Stephanie, Reverend Doug, Father Paul, and Pastor Judy. Equip them with health and strength, and renew them with times of rest and refreshment. We pray for our season of renewal, for ourselves and for our church. Sharpen our spiritual hearing, so that we may be guided by your Holy Spirit. May the light on the hill burn brightly, Lord. We pray for this good land of Canada and ask that you would continue to have dominion from sea to sea. We pray for our leaders, Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, Premier Doug Ford, our local MPPs, and our Mayor Kevin Ash. Give them wisdom and good judgment as they make decisions on our behalf. Make Pickering continue to be a family-centered community with adequate green space, affordable housing, and a healthy living environment. We pray for our troubled world, Lord, and all the many areas of conflict. We pray for the end of gang wars in Haiti and for the war between Russia and Ukraine, and ask that peace would come soon. We watch as the conflict between Israel and Iran escalates and ask that voices of reason would rise in the midst of the chaos. Lord, for those who have requested our prayers, we ask that your healing presence and comfort would be felt by each of these dear ones. Into your healing light, we lift Cora and Milton, Jillian, Kamala, Carol, Paul, Eva and Steve, Diane and Nigel. We lift up Pauline, Larry, Kirk, Gary, Karen, Lorna, and Ray. We lift up Wayne, Oscar, Renate, Gertrude, George, and Brian. We lift up Rick and Irene. We pray for those who have those who have died and been called home into God's presence, and remember Bill Kibblewhite this day. Grant eternal rest unto those who are dying, and comfort those who mourn. These and all our burdens we send to the cross of Christ, and all of our hopes we set on the risen Christ. Watch over us and keep us in the light of your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us take a moment to gather our thoughts and think about the things we have done in the past that we shouldn't have done, things we have said that we shouldn't have said. Let us prepare ourselves in heart and mind to worship and confess our sins, so that we may obtain forgiveness by His infinite goodness and mercy. Let us say together the prayer of confession. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Would you stand, please? The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Would you exchange the peace with those nearby? Join together in singing our offertory hymn, Freely, Freely. As we celebrate the resurrection, renew your gift of life within us. And we ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, the risen Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of heaven and earth, because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give knowledge of salvation in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, with angels and archangels and the whole company of heaven, we lift our voices to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy, mighty and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and the suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who, on the cross, opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share in this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be all glory and honor, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we pray together. Died with you on the cross. Now we are raised to new life. We were buried in your tomb.
Now we share in your resurrection.
Live in us that we may live in you.
Thanks be to God.
And we'll offer the prayer for those receiving the, you know what I mean, the people at home, them folks. Thank you, Lord Jesus Christ,
for all the benefits you have given me, for all the pains and insults you have borne for me. Even though I cannot now receive you sacramentally, I ask you to come spiritually into my heart. O most merciful Redeemer, friend and brother, may I know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day. Amen.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
There will be prayer ministry available in the narthex if you would like more prayer. And we invite you to come to the altar of the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your presence with us. Just as you were with the disciples and you said, "Peace I leave with you," let that peace descend upon us this day, we pray, that as we gather together in your name, we may feel your risen presence with us. And we ask it through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the Church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever.
Amen.
And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. We'll stand and sing our closing, "Go Now in Peace."
Let us bless the Lord. Alleluia.